Howard J. Caulfield III is the richest man in the world. It's been assessed that his personal fortune equals the wealth of the seventh richest nation in the world. But Howard J. Caulfield III has a problem. He doesn't want to die. And with all that money, he doesn't intend to. His private medical research staff believe they have solved the problem. Whenever any organ in Howard J. Caulfield III's body appears to be running down, it will be instantly replaced. You can help. Become a Howard J. Caulfield III spare bit donor. If your organs are accepted, you could become part of the world's richest man. Just think what your kidney could do with all that money to spend. Imagine your spleen relaxing on a beach in the Caribbean, or attending a top-level meeting with the President of the United States. Picture your lower intestine sitting next to one of the world's most beautiful women in its own private plane. Don't you owe it to your organs to give them the best? They work for you. Isn't it time you started working for them? Just fill in the form in your local press, and you will receive a Howard J. Caulfield III spare bit donor card, together with a list of companies of which your organ is now chief shareholder. Howard J. Caulfield III. Become an important part of an important man.
Cliche! Welcome to Cliche, starring Carol Heyman, Nick Maloney, Simon Malloy, and Brian Southwood.
No, Kenny, that's no good to me. That's no good to me at all. Come in, Frank, with you in a minute.
Fine.
Look, Summer Love Songs is no good with the release date in November. I want it to hit the record shops at the end of this month. If not, the whole project gets shelved, and so do you. You do that. Frank, hi, take a seat.
Hi.
What have you got for me?
I think I've got some great new ideas, Mr. Colby, for marketing the compilation albums.
New blood, new ideas. That's what I hired you for, Frank.
The problem, as I see it, sir, is this. We need a new hook, a new marketing angle. We've covered everything with the compilation albums. 20 golden love ballads, 20 great disco stompers, heavy metal, classical greats, 20 golden everything. We need a new approach.
Yeah. Well, what have you got for me?
I've taken the liberty, sir, of preparing a demonstration video of some of my marketing ideas.
I like initiative, Frank. Hit me.
Just one second, sir. Here we go.
ATEL proudly presents a great new album, 20 Golden Baldies, 20 Golden Love Songs from 20 Balding Artists. Golden Baldies, 20 recording stars who are light on top, completely bald or just brush it over to one side to cover up the shiny bit, all on one fabulous album, including Elton John, Telly Savalas,
hold it, Frank.
Bald woman ABBA,
hold it. Enough, kill it. No, Frank, no.
No?
No.
You have to admit it's a new angle.
Just because all the artists are bald, that's no reason to put them on a compilation album.
It's so hard to find something we haven't already done, Mr. Colby.
That's what you're paid for, Frank.
Well, wait. Just let me play this next one. I think you're going to like this.
ATEL presents a great new album, 20 Golden Gays, 20
Kill
original
it,
chartbusters from 20 gay artists.
You don't like it?
I don't even want to discuss it.
But, Mr. Colby, it seems such a bright, new, original angle to me, sir.
Have you got anything else?
Many more, sir. How about 20 golden big noses? 20 artists with enormous hoopers?
No, good.
Rod Stewart, Streisand, Barry Manilow...
No, Frank, no.
20 recording artists who share the same dentist. 20 singer-songwriters with size 8 shoes.
Haven't you got anything more upmarket? Something with a little more taste?
Mr. Colby, leave it to me, sir. I am a master of good taste. This is my personal favourite.
ATEL proudly presents 20 golden handicap composers. Beethoven, Delius.
Get out, Frank.
20 people with enormous phone bills.
Get out.
20 golden bucket noises.
Out.
20 rock and rollers with smelly feet.
Get out, Frank. You're fired.
20 male vocalists with fat lips.
Get out and stay out.
How about 20 golden rip-offs?
Say, Jane, aren't you ready yet? Jimmy and Ronnie are waiting in the car outside, ready to take us to the movies.
Oh, you'll have to go without me, Connie. Tell the boys I have a headache.
Why can't you come?
Just look at my face. It's covered in ugly spots and blackheads. I can't let Jimmy see me like this.
Oh, I used to have an awful complexion, too.
You? You're kidding.
Sure, until I used this. It's the new cosmetic from Simone Robespierre. Spray on Farrah Fawcett Major's face. One little psst all over your face, and you look just like the famous actress herself. Here, try it.
Wow, it really works. I really do look like Farrah Fawcett Majors. Bye-bye, blackheads. Hello, Jimmy.
Spray-on faces are really great. They come in three super colors. Farrah Fawcett Majors spray-on face, Diana Ross spray-on face, and new Shanghai Lil spray-on face for all you yellow people.
But won't my date be able to tell?
Who cares? Jimmy's wearing his Sylvester Stallone spray-on face, and Ronnie's got the new Robert Redford spray-on face.
Looking good's one thing, but I'm still the same old boring Jane inside.
No problem, Jane. Just use one of Simone Robespierre's new range of spray-on personalities. One little psst, and you can be everything you always wanted to be.
Wow, great! But will Jimmy like me for myself?
Sure. With new spray-on personality, he'll like you for anyone you want to be.
From Simone Robespierre. New spray-on cosmetics. If you can't face your face, spray on someone else's.
The final cadences of the last symphony of the Spanish composer Don Dimitri, who died early this morning at the age of 86. Cliché now pays its own special tribute to Don Dimitri, one of the true musical innovators of this century. Don Dimitri's life was characterized by his refusal to accept the conventions and mores of the society in which he lived. In 1926, he went to the Sorbonne to study music. Rapidly, it became apparent he could not reconcile his own ideas with those of the establishment, and after 3 hours at the university, he left to set up his own school of musical thought. Professor Blakehurst takes up the story.
Don Dimitri's biggest contribution to musical theory was the decative. Instead of the conventional 8-note scale, the octave, he initiated the 10-note scale, the decative. He invented 2 new notes, H and J. Instead of do, re, mi, fa, so, la, ti, do, the decative would run do, re, mi, fa, so, wo, bo, la, ti, do. And in reverse, do, ti, la, bo, wo, so, fa, mi, re, do.
And he wrote all his symphonies using this scale?
Indeed. And the instruments in his orchestra had to be adapted accordingly. Pianos were fitted with extra black keys. Flutes now came in 4 sections instead of 3, and accordions were scrapped, as the decative made them far too long for human beings to play. Trombones ceased to be a musical instrument, and now became a lethal weapon. And the lengthening of bassoons and saxophones extended the mouthpiece into the region of the lower intestine. Incidentally, in Don Dimitri's orchestra, women were banned from playing the cello.
What other significant changes were inspired by the decative?
Time signatures were changed. Instead of 3/4 time, it was now 0.75 time. 7/8 time became 0.875 time, and common time, or 4/4 time, was now simply 1. Don Dimitri's quartets comprised of 5 players, and his triangles had 2 sides, neither of them connected.
And now the last note of the last chord of the last cadence is written. At the grand old age of 86, Don Dimitri passed away this morning. Never one to do things in a conventional way, he died in a manner he would probably have appreciated, trying to suck a kazoo instead of blowing it. He inhaled the kazoo, it became lodged in his throat, and he died to the tune of Yankee Doodle Dandy. We leave you now with the strains of what is universally acknowledged as his masterwork, Quintet for Seven Instruments in H Minor, the only work he ever wrote in 0.333 recurring time, a time signature which never actually allows you to reach the end of the first bar, hence its popular title, Don Dimitri's Unfinished Synth. Good night.
Pass the salt.
How's the stew? Is it all right?
You could have done with a bit more salt.
Well, I put salt in.
I'm just saying. It could have done with a bit more.
Well, I assure you, I put the usual amount in.
I don't care how much you put in. I'm just saying it could have done with a bit more.
Well, there's salt on the table. Why don't you use that?
I know there's salt on the table.
Well, why don't you use that?
I've used it. Look, I don't want to get into an argument. All I'm saying is, when you served the stew, there wasn't enough salt in it for me.
Well, I think it must be your imagination. I put the usual amount of salt in.
It's not sinking in, is it?
What isn't?
There's enough salt in it now. I'm quite happy with the amount of salt in it now. All I'm saying, when you served it, it could have done with a bit more.
All right, I'll put more salt in it in future. After 23 years, you've suddenly decided you want more salt in your stew.
I'm not saying put more salt
in. Don't shout.
I'm not shouting.
Yes, you are.
Look, I'm quite happy to put the salt in myself.
Well, why are you making such a fuss, then, about there not being enough salt
in it? All I was doing was answering your question. You said, is there enough salt in? And I said, no, there isn't.
No,
yes, you did.
I'm
sorry, you did. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. You said, I know. Excuse me. Look, if I could just get a word. If I could just get a word. Look, I'm sorry. If I could just get a word. No, no, no. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Wait, no, wait. You're saying, no, if I can get a word. No, I'm sorry. Wait a minute. You're saying you didn't say it.
Yes.
You sure?
I'm positive.
What didn't you say?
What?
What didn't you say?
What? What do you mean, what didn't I say? What didn't you say?
Well, I didn't say anything. That's not what it's about. It's about what you didn't
Look,
say.
Look, you've got your opinion and I've got mine.
You've got your opinion about what?
I'm not getting involved in an argument.
You can't even
you.
Remember what we were arguing about, can you?
Look, I don't want to get
Look,
involved.
I knew you couldn't. You're arguing and you can't even remember what it's about.
All right, you tell me.
Me tell
yes,
you.
Yes, yes, tell me.
Me tell you what you were arguing about. My God, women!
Yes, you can't remember.
Oh, it's pointless arguing with you.
It's pointless arguing with you.
How can you have an argument with
pointless
you? You can't even remember what you're arguing about
I
half the time.
Well, I know what I'm arguing about.
I'm sorry,
about.
I'm
forget.
Sorry. I'm sorry,
no, I'm
I never
sorry.
Forget
you're
what I'm arguing
about.
I'm sorry, I never
Excuse
forget what I'm
me.
Arguing about.
I think you'll find that you do.
All right, give me an example then.
What of?
What of?
Yes, yes, what of?
What of? Oh, shut up.
Oh, shut up yourself.
There's no point in arguing with you. Absolutely no point at all.
Absolutely no point in arguing with you. All right, fine. Just forget it. Pass the salt, please.
Ha! There you are, you see? Women! My God! Pass the salt!
So if you let me love you, it's for sure I'm gonna love you all the way.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Village Idiot, 1980. And now, meet your host, Brian Southwood.
Thank you, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to yet another Mr. Village Idiot competition. We have here tonight over 30 idiots from villages all over the world competing for that coveted crown, Mr. Village Idiot 1980. We've already seen the boys in sub-aqua wear and dressed as barnyard animals, so let's see them for a final time in the nude. Couldn't we have our first Village Idiot, please?
Contestant number 6, Mr. West Germany.
Mr. West Germany is Hans Müller, who hails from Innsbruck. His hobbies include collecting sausages, sitting on walls, salivating, and Russian literature. He enjoys eating it. If he wins tonight, Hans says he would like to become the all-seeing, all-knowing master of the universe. And if he can't do that, he'd like a job in a supermarket.
Now, if you'd just step up here, Hans. Now, Hans, can I ask you, when did you first realize that you were an idiot? Hans Müller, thank you.
And Hans has answered the question in Navajo, the Red Indian dialect. And that's really going to impress the judges.
And our next village idiot, please.
Contestant number 44, Mr. Great Britain.
Mr. Great Britain is Henry Cowell from Eccles. Henry says his ambition is to meet President Carter and remove his intestinal tract. If he had one wish, it would be to see peace on Earth, Mars and Jupiter, start a war in the rest of the planets, and then hide in his little hole in the cellar.
And now the judges have the unenviable task of deciding who to choose out of all the contestants as the most idiotic village idiot in the world.
And in reverse order, the winner is Mr. North Pole.
Mr. North Pole looks absolutely stunned. You can see the tears running down his cheeks. And no wonder. Mr. Great Britain has just met him in the groin. It's a very emotional moment.
Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand please as we present the great Baldini.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you, all of you, Thank you, don't strain yourselves. Ladies and gentlemen, it's really nice to be back here at the Marine Theatre in Cleethorpes. Ladies and gentlemen, the phenomena you are about to witness has taken me 25 years to perfect. I have travelled through India and the mystic East in search of the secrets I'm about to share with you. Ladies and gentlemen, may I have two volunteers from the audience? Ladies and gentlemen, they must be man and wife. You, sir, and you, madam. Thank you, thank you. A big hand, ladies and gentlemen. And your name, sir?
John.
Speak up louder, please, sir.
John.
John. And your name, madam?
Karen.
Karen and John. Have I ever met you before?
No.
I have never met them before, ladies and gentlemen. John, I want you to stand here on this spot marked X.
Here?
That's fine. Karen, I want you to go behind the screen over here. Yes, this screen over here, Karen. No one can see you over here. Come on, Karen. Nothing to be frightened of. Karen, I want you to take off all your clothes.
My clothes? I'm not taking them off.
Please, Karen. I must have complete faith.
No.
Please, Karen. Look at me. Look at me. I must have your complete trust. No one will see you. You will be perfectly safe. I must have your complete faith. Thank you. As Karen undresses John, I will explain to you what I want you to do.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you have a great psychic rapport with your wife. Please, John. Say nothing. Say nothing, John. I want you to visualize in your mind her naked body, which you cannot see because she is behind that screen. Then, with your mind, John, purely with your psychic forces, John, I want you to try and seduce your wife. Please, John, say nothing. Say nothing. Say nothing, John. Ladies and gentlemen, you understand what we're trying to do. John is standing here, 15 yards away from Karen. He cannot see her. He cannot touch her. Karen, are you completely undressed?
Yes.
Thank you. Please, quiet. Silence. I must have total quiet for this, ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, John is going to try and seduce you with his mind. Do you understand?
Yes, I think so.
Ladies and gentlemen, I must have silence. I am standing here next to John. And because I have travelled India and the mystic East, I have acquired the technique. And this is nothing magical, ladies and gentlemen. This is something every one of you can do with training. John, start seducing Karen with your mind. Are you doing that?
Yes.
I am going to try and act as a medium, John. I am going to try and act as a medium to translate John's psychic thoughts into the physical plane. Karen, I am coming behind the screen. John, I am receiving your psychic waves. We have a great rapport. Yes. Yes. The impulse is very strong. John, what are you thinking?
I'm thinking of kissing my wife all over.
Karen, what is happening to you?
Being kissed all over.
Ladies and gentlemen, the great Baldini. Now, John, what are you thinking?
I'd rather not say.
Karen, what is happening?
I'd rather not say.
Ladies and gentlemen, the great Baldini scores again.
That was Cliche, written by Rob Grant and Doug Naylor, with musical accompaniment by Pete Lingwood and starring Carol Heyman.
Sure, until I use this. It's the new cosmetic from Simone Robespierre. Spray on Farrah Fawcett Major's face.
Nick Maloney.
There's enough salt in it now. I'm quite happy with the amount of salt in it now. All I'm saying, when you served it, it could have done with a bit more.
Simon Malloy.
No, Frank. No. Just because all the artists are bald, that's no reason to put them on a compilation album.
And Brian Southwood.
Instead of do re mi fa so la ti do, the decative would run do re mi fa so wo bo la ti do. And in reverse, do ti la bo wo so fa mi re do.
Cliche. Cliche was produced in Manchester by Ron McDonnell.
Good night, Mr. McDonnell.
And that's the end of Cliche for another week. Some of you may be interested to know a Cliche record is available from most record stores, price £4.99. A book of the series is also on sale, price £3.50. Also on sale is the Cliche 413 four-wheel drive loading shovel with a Carlston Brown swivel head, price £4,000. Also available, the special new Cliche jar of mollusk spawn with highlights from the series on the label from most seafood stores, price 95p.
Its supporters claim that transcendental meditation taps the source of creative intelligence within the individual to bring out inner peace and tranquility. Brian, you've been practicing transcendental meditation for over 15 years. How would you evaluate its effect on your life?
Well, I'd say I'm much calmer now, much more serene, sort of more laid back, you know.
Uh-huh.